to our service at Cassius United Methodist Church for Sunday, May the 3rd, 2020. I invite you to join me in our call to worship at this time. Can you hear the voice of God? We hear God calling us by name. Are you troubled or distressed? We come here to find a place to rest for a while. Come and find a guide who knows these lands. We come to praise our shepherding God, whose pathways and doors lead to life. I invite you to join us in the opening hymn. Children to come and listen to a children's moment. Well, good morning, and I'm glad you're here with me today. You know, these are such strange times. I know you see your parents going, ugh, what's next, as they watch the news. And it's just so frustrating. You know, it makes you sometimes just want to go outside and get some fresh air, or maybe have some comfort food like some macaroni and cheese. But you know, it reminds me of how the disciples probably felt after Christ's resurrection. When they saw him, they were so excited and so happy to see him, but then he'd go away. And they'd be left alone to wonder what they should do and where they should go and, you know, what was going to be the next move. Would Christ come back and see him again, or was he gone for good? They didn't really know. So it must have been a frustrating time for them, because things changed every day, just like things are changing for us right now. So one day, Peter said, I'm going fishing. And he got his net, and all the disciples said, hey, I think I'll go fishing too, because they thought, well, maybe we'll need to go back to our previous careers or what we used to do to make money. And so they took their nets and they went out. It was at nighttime too. They went out and they fished all night long. And they were fishermen. They knew what to do, but you know what? They didn't catch one fish. They fished and they fished. They put the nets out here. They put the nets out there. No fish. Well, as the sun came up, and as they looked toward the shore, they saw someone standing there calling to them, saying, hey, hey, come on in. And they you know, said, we've been fishing all night and haven't caught a single fish. And they didn't know it, but it was Jesus. And Jesus looked at them, and he said, look, put your nets out on the right side of the boat and pull them in. They said, but we've been fishing all night and we haven't caught a thing. And he said, try the right side. And they did. And their nets were so full when they pulled them back in, they could hardly get them in the boat. Well, you know, we're sometimes like that too. We think we know just how to do everything. Things that we've done before, we do it just right. But things aren't going well and we get worried and frustrated. But if we'll just listen to what God and Jesus are telling us, put our nets in the right side, like he's saying, and trust him, things will go better. So I invite you today, during this time, even when you're frustrated, just to be still and listen for Jesus saying, I love you very much. Amen.
Please join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Gives us strength when we come to God. so much for the music. Our scripture this morning is John 21. 21, 1 through 14. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Dubinius, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. Simon Peter said, "I'm going out to fish." And they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got in the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It's the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say that, "It's the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and he jumped in the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals with fish on it and some bread. And Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you've caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even so, with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." And none of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew that it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread, and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The people who are teachers of Scripture will tell you that it appears that John chapter 20 is the ending to John's testimony, his gospel about Jesus. John ends chapter 20 with these verses. "Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." But chapter 21 is necessary. It shows that the risen Lord is a part of our everyday life. Friends, be mindful. Be watchful for signs of the presence of the resurrected Jesus in your everyday life. Now, our best understanding is that the final appearance and final interaction of Jesus as resurrection didn't occur in around Jerusalem like so many of the appearances that did. This last appearance takes place along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, 100 miles to the north of Jerusalem. The text simply says this: "After these things, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Galilee." We take that to mean that after all of the other appearances had ceased, now we don't know how much time that was. It could have been weeks, it could have been months. It would have taken the disciples about 5 days of travel on foot to get from Jerusalem, where the resurrection occurred, crucifixion, the resurrection, and all the appearances had occurred, to get up into Galilee. So if they had waited in Jerusalem until all the other appearances came to an end, it would have been maybe even a couple of months before this story happened. And Jesus had told the two Marys on the morning of the resurrection to tell the disciples to meet him in Galilee. So they had moved to the place where he would meet them again. The angel told them, "Go quickly and tell his disciples, he's risen from the dead and he's going ahead of you into Galilee." Think about this for a minute. It is resurrection. Jesus did not return to the temple to show off to the chief priest and the other religious rulers that he was not dead. Jesus didn't appear to Pontius Pilate. Can you imagine what that would be like? For the crucified Jesus, now resurrected Jesus, to walk through the wall into the presence of Pontius Pilate and go, "Who?" No. By telling them that he would meet them in Galilee, Jesus is saying something very important. I'll continue to be a part of your life. All of Jesus' disciples were from Galilee except for Judas. They met Jesus in around the hometowns. So when they were told that the resurrected Jesus would meet them in Galilee, maybe they were thinking back to those early days when they were first heard Jesus teaching and preaching, and when he first called them to follow him and to be his disciples. This is another thing here. If you want to be a part of the ongoing work of Jesus in the world, you'll not meet him in church buildings so much, or in places where the religious elite or where the political elite look down on other people. No. God sends the resurrected Jesus, his son, out into the edge of the world, and that's where God is unfolding his kingdom's work. Galilee is a far piece from Jerusalem. It's like going to the other side of the track of society. There's nothing special that happens in Galilee, nothing exciting, nothing flashy, nothing that other people would desire to be a part of. It's in the normalcy of life, and the regular, the boring, the common, that's where God is doing his work in the world and your and my life. That's where we meet God. In the midst of this health crisis we're in the midst of an economic crisis that we're in, Jesus is out there touching the lives that need healing and hope. It's here in Cashers on this plateau in Western North Carolina that the Boys and Girls Club of Cashers and a group of local restaurants are feeding 150 meals three times a week to families that are in need. It's our local Fishes and Loaves ministry that are giving out food for pickup twice a week. It's the staff of the Blue Ridge Public School fixing food and delivering 219 meals 5 days a week to the remote areas of our county. Jesus is in the middle of it all. His spirit activates our desire to touch the lives of our neighbors. That's living in the resurrection. The resurrected Jesus went into the world, and friends, that's where we will meet him. He's out there, and he's calling you to join him. The disciples have returned to their homes. That's where they met Jesus in Galilee. That's where the great life and faith adventure started. And for them, now it appears that it's all over. So Peter says to the other six, I'm going fishing. What he was saying was, I'm going back to fishing. I'm going back to my old way of life. I'm going back to my old job. And the other disciples respond, we're going to do that too. These former followers of Jesus are returning to their first line of work and turning away from the call of Jesus to come and to follow and to become fishers of men, not fishers of fish. For them, the Jesus dream is over. What once was so exciting has come to an end. It's time to go back to the work that we know the best. Think. Think of the times of great loss in your life. Deep disappointment in your life. It's a natural thing, isn't it? To take a step back to the thing you thought you could depend on, maybe another relationship or some other group of friends or another job, but to take a step backwards, to go back home, so to speak. Or you return to what worked in the past. Now, I don't know about you. I can identify with Peter. I've been down this road. At times of big change and shocking disappointment and letdown, I have been tempted to try to take a step backwards to a more predictable past. Face it. Sometimes in life, you just want to throw in the towel and give up, shuck it all. And if that's where you find yourself today, take heart. You're not alone. There are many of us who've gone down that road. In our times of great disappointment, God comes again seeking us, calling us back to a trust relationship with him. Peter says he's going back to fishing. And John says they immediately went out and entered into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. This is what happens when you give up on God and strike out on your own, in your own path. This is the results that we get when we lean on ourselves. Empty nets. No results. It just doesn't work. John 15:5 says, Jesus said this, and remember it. It's real important. I'm the vine. You're the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. But apart of me, you can do nothing. You can do not one thing. Abiding is a description of being in deep relationship with Jesus. Ultimately, if we're not abiding, grafted in, drawing on him, we achieve nothing, or nothing that has lasting impact. When you find yourself no longer following God's call in your life, it seems like nothing will go right. Everything's uncoordinated, disjointed. Only when you get back into the flow of God's Spirit leading your life will things start to fall back into place again. Jesus said, seek first God's kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So back to fishing. Back to the fish store. But when day had already come, Jesus stood on the beach. Yet the disciples didn't know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to them, Now, this is different than the translation we read at the beginning of the sermon. The word actually is children. Jesus says to them, "Children, have you anything to eat?" And they say, "No." This is the only time of the Gospels when this word is used by Jesus to talk to his followers. Children. Some have called it diminutive, making them little. But you know, that's not Jesus. That's not the one that we've come to know. That isn't the way he treats his beloved ones. That's not Jesus. Jesus' word, children, "Do you have anything to eat?" reminds us that God is our Father. And that the love of God the Father and the Son is for us as a good father to his children. Children, do you have anything to eat? Jesus is understanding their disappointment, their fatigue, their confusion, and how their failure to be successful of returning to their old way of life has got to be embarrassing and discouraging. Their former way of making a living isn't going to work. He doesn't make fun of them. He doesn't scold them. He understands their struggle to hold on to the dream that came alive in them when they first followed him. He understands how tired they've become. Not being able to see Jesus on a daily basis. And he understands what they're going through. He calls them affectionately children. He offers them compassion, love, and care. And my friends, Jesus understands your struggle. He understands my struggle with trusting him today, especially in the situation we've come to as not only a country, but an entire world. Hear his call to you as loving affection, "My child, I see, I hear, I understand, and I love you, my child. I love you." He said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you'll find some." I do wonder if one of our renewed fishermen who were formerly disciples of the rabbi named Jesus, I do wonder if one of them might have grumbled under his breath, "What difference does it make to fish on the other side of this boat?" You can tell that I've had my own struggles with this in returning to the past. They are going through lots of discouragement and grumbling. They cast it, and they weren't able to draw it in for the multitude of fish. How many fish were there? I'm going to jump ahead a little bit. 153. The number is not significant at all. There's no biblical understanding of why that number is important. But there is an application because Jesus, as the resurrected one, is concerned about the concrete needs of the disciples and us too. The need to finally get a big catch to feel good about returning to fishing. And it's about abundance in life. Abundance in life comes not by skill, not by luck, not by the signs of the farmer's almanac, but through following God. The number 153 has no significance other than they were large fish. They were very large fish. During these days, Rome had created a growing fishing industry on the Sea of Galilee. In fact, the lake has been renamed for the reigning emperor Tiberius and is called Lake Tiberius. They were also taxing all of the fishermen for fishing on the lake. And all of the fine, good, large fish were by law, gathered, salted, and nice fish were shipped to the elite homes of Rome. Nice fish. were no longer available for the common folks of the region of Galilee. Here is a great catch. A large number of really fine large fish. It shows us walking with the resurrected Son of God is the way, is the route to abundance and plenty. The question comes up here. Why didn't the disciples recognize Jesus? I used to do some night fishing, and one of the experiences I remember is when the sun started peeking up after being out all night fishing on Lake Fontana. There would be that sort of shock of the eyes, but that's not what it's really about. The larger meaning is this. If you're not open to the presence of God, if you're not circuiting, if you're not awake, if you're not watchful for God, the Son, or the move of the Holy Spirit, you'll miss what he's doing right in front of you. Resurrection means that God is at work in the concreteness of our lives all around us. For you and me, even in the isolation of these days, sheltered at home, in the midst of loneliness, in our missing of our friends and family, Jesus, the resurrected one, is right there in the middle of our lives. The core issue of the story isn't about fishing at all. It's about trusting God. When things don't go the way we'd hope for, dream for, plan for, even when the picture of the future is cloudy and obscured, do we trust him? Do you see the resurrected Jesus' presence in your life? Do you trust he's in the midst of your life, even when you can't see it? They caught fish because they listened to the Lord. And the question each of us must ask ourselves is, am I willing to listen for the voice of God and act in our faith? John continues that the disciple, therefore, who loved Jesus, said to Peter, it's the Lord. So Simon Peter heard it, who was cut around him and swam to the shore. I imagine as the disciples gathered there on the seashore, it was a quiet, worshipful moment. It wasn't a high-five tide, but it was very somber reverence. So when they got to the land, they saw a fire of coals there, fish laid on it, and bread. This is no spiritualized Jesus. This is one that gathers wood, starts a fire, bakes bread, and bakes the fish. It is a transformed, physically transformed Jesus. There are many events recorded where Jesus feeds people, and he's about to feed them a holy resurrection breakfast. And I imagine they're hungry. Not hungry because they've been fishing all night, but because they have been in need of the presence of Jesus. Jesus around the campfire will feed their deepest needs. His invitation was simple. Come and eat breakfast. It's simple and profound. Come and eat. Satisfying the longing of your soul for nourishments and sustenance, let me be the source of encouragement and strength for your life, Jesus is saying. Let me provide for your needs. Let me be a part of you and you a part of me again. Jesus came and took the bread, gave it to them, and the fish likewise. And they ate together, Jesus and the disciples. They continued to share in a meal of communion, a different kind of communion meal. Every time they got together to worship and they broke bread and called his name, They were fed. They were celebrating his presence, his resurrection. He's risen. Risen indeed. So very personally, the disciple story is my story. It's your story. Where are you presently with God? Where are you with Jesus? Are you like the disciples out on the sea? Have you decided to pursue your own path, your own choices, do things your own way? In your work life, in your family life, in the direction of your life, perhaps you haven't made a conscious decision to do so, to strike out on your own, but you became distracted by something in the world. Maybe you have found that your passion for Christ has come cool, that living for Christ, you aren't doing that so much anymore. We used to call that backsliding or slacking off on your daily commitment to trust God, to walk with him. Where are you? Where are you in your relationship with Jesus? Do you go to him daily to be fed? Do you practice abiding in him? Do you nurture a daily relationship with him? Are you as close to God as you once were? Or do you long for the excitement, the dream, the passions that you once had? Perhaps the problem isn't that you're too busy with other things to have a meaningful relationship with the Lord. Maybe it's you've lost your first love. Are you following God's call that's to your life? Or are you leaning in your own understanding of your life? Is this striking a need in your life? If you've been away from the wellspring of God's Spirit, it's been a while since you've tasted the goodness of God's grace and love. Now is a chance to come home. Don't pass it up. Now is the time to renew your walk with God. Now is the time to be fed by the resurrected one. Open to him. Let him in a very powerful way, fully alive within you, feed you and sustain you in your life. It's in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'll invite you to look at your worship guide and join us in our service of communion. For those of you who are an active part of our church, you'll notice that we are experimenting with learning to do communion differently, that is safe and welcomes all. Come to the Lord's table, all you who love him. Come to the Lord's table, confess your sin. Come to the Lord's table and be at peace. We've not believed you or trusted in your power. Lord, help our unbelief. We have stained our souls with our action and our inaction. Cleanse us, Lord. We're broken by disease, bruised by the sins of others, Weakened and unable to repair ourselves, heal us, Lord. We ignore your call to center our lives in you, and so are deaf to the hopes and the cries of the poor, the sick, the needy, and the earth. Ground us, Lord. When we confess our sinful ways, God abundantly pardons. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory to God. By one Spirit, we are all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue the things that make for peace and build up our common life. We're experiencing today communion in a new way. Though physically separated from one another, we are still bound together as a family through our faith and baptism. As members of the household of God, we now join together virtually, yet still present to one another as we gather from across the miles. This presence is marked by our shared praises, our shared hearing and affirming of God's word, and now our shared celebration of this, his holy meal. The peace and presence of the Lord be with us. So we lift up our hearts. We lift them up to God. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God, because it is the right thing to do, not only now, but always, day after day after day. Day after day after day. We thank you, Creator God, that you made us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away, our love failing and our bodies diseased, you reached out to us again and again, providing healing, wholeness, and new life. When the flood came, you provided an ark. When the plagues came, you provided safety. When evening came, you provided a pillar of fire. And when the exile came, you provided a new song. Day after day, your love remained steadfast. Day after day after day. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join them in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is your Son who came to preach the good news to the poor, released to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, freed the oppressed, and announced the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick. He healed the sick. He is healing the sick now. He is healing the sick now. He will heal the sick day after day after day. Day after day after day. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples, and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, and do it in remembrance of me. Let us be a community of healers and hope givers as together we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Let them be for us the body and blood of Christ. so that we may be for the world the body of Christ, made whole by his witness, passion, and life. In this season of social distancing, may you remind us that we are never spiritually distanced from you. We belong to your body. We belong to your body. May the Spirit use us to heal and reconcile in Jesus' name. We will heal and reconcile in Jesus' name. And now, Holy Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to the whole world. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This bread reminds us that any life, no matter how broken or sick or distorted it may become, can be made whole again. The cup reminds us that no matter how empty or lonely or isolated a life may become, it can be filled again. These are the gifts of God for the family of God. Thanks be to God. I invite you, as we serve here in the sanctuary, that you prayerfully partake in the Holy Communion by the appropriate means that you made for yourself in your homes. First, with the bread, either taking it yourself or passing it to your housemate or your partner, and then the wine, and to pray your prayers of thanksgiving for the presence of Jesus in this moment. Let us pray. Day after day after day, you give yourselves to us. In two or three gathered in your name, in connection across the miles, in the bread and in the wine. As we go from this gathering around your table, May we feel restored to your body, companioned by your people, sustained by the power of the Spirit, as we witness to your healing and reconciling work. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Of Jesus and witness to your faith, your passion, and your service that He is alive in your life. Amen.
Our choral benediction.